Malawi, a beautiful green country in Central East Africa, where, in our case, rural agriculture meets technology and innovation. Two teams of researchers from Michigan State University and the Lilongwe University of Agriculture and Natural Resources, made up of Dr. Charles Steinfield, Dr. Susan Weich, LUANAR faculty Hastings Chiwasa, and Jafet Nchokulu, PhD student Tian Tsai, and documentary video specialist Kirk Mason, are here meeting with scholars to discuss an innovative project we have all helped to develop, and the reason why we are all here. We are in Lilongwe, the capital of Malawi, at the Lilongwe University of Agriculture and Natural Resources. As soon as we arrived in Lilongwe, we met with the Vice Chancellor of the university and explained to him and other faculty the details of our study. What we're doing is this: using a loose structure of the methodology of the Indian non-governmental organization, Digital Green, we will be implementing a series of short videos in which rural farmers participate in the creation of videos that will help them in their competency of mobile phones. Mobile phones can be used for gathering information like market prices, weather patterns, prices of fertilizer. Often, though, they are not utilized to their full potential. We are hoping the videos can help them realize or understand what a useful instrument mobile phones can really be.
The structure of the district and the sections.
Yeah.
So you have data as a district headquarters.
Yeah.
Within data, you have got a number of EPAs. One of which is Lintipe. It's subdivided. So we're going to Lintipe extension planning area. Within this EPA, there are sections. So these are 26.
Yeah.
26 sections. So a section is a block of villages, this one. So we have what you call group village and a village. A village is the lowest level.
So again, this is just explaining what I told you earlier, what the IRB is.
First, though, we met with the students from LUANAR and the University of Malawi, who would be helping with the enumeration of the baseline surveys. They were trained in federally required IRB, and we collaborated with them on the editing of the questionnaire in order to perfect it. For 2 days, we sat in a conference room editing, but some things were missing. We headed out to the extension office of the EPA we would be surveying parts of, Lintipe.
And we met with Muriel, who's the head of that office, and the point of this meeting was to help us in selecting the right villages where we will conduct a baseline survey. So it's very challenging because there isn't necessarily any one single list of households from which we can draw a random sample. So we had to get some information about each of the sections that are inside this extension planning area. So we could choose two that were quite comparable, but far enough apart so that there wasn't going to be a high likelihood of a lot of interaction and communication between the two villages, because one of them we will do the video treatment and the other we won't. So we have Chisiri is one section, and inside Chisiri we will focus on a group called Chiku Fikani, and there are a number of villages inside Chiku Fikani, and we will get the list of all the households in those villages. And the other section we chose is Diamfui, and inside Diamfui there is a group called Lumwira that has four villages. So I think it's the right first step. I am Charles Steinfield, and I'm a professor at Michigan State University. Thank you for hosting us.
One last step. Before heading to Dedza District to begin the baseline surveys, we thought it would be good to test it on a nearby village in case we missed anything. Just down the street from the LUANAR, a nearby village would be our test subject.
We're headed out to Dedza to gather the baseline survey data. We're visiting a couple of sections inside the Lintipe EPA. We're arranging to gather a new sample, and we'll be talking to approximately 60 villagers,
in each area that we've sampled in order to get more information about their sources of information and their cell phone use.
Right now we are finding the participants from the list the village had provided, and Chip is circling the one we are going to select in our survey. We are doing a random number way to select the participants. So we are choosing the, we start from two, and then we select the every three letter, three numbers.
You finished?
Yeah. Tipuliseni, tukumbutseni, tijambuleni, tizaonege, nawiyo, weno zilu tina kari umuno, kudu, kudu, muzi unduja u, takulandi ya kipangani mwoma suka, sipiru kambari kambu kumariza.
Zobi.
So yesterday we did 38, and today we're expecting 22.
This is our second site. We've been collecting data right here in Delta. We started at what was that? Diampwe. Yeah. And now this is Yisili.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm good.
The data is all about how the farmers use their phones. At the first site, we didn't find a lot of farmers with phones, but I think it's actually much better right here in Tisini.
And then we're also remaining with one more section, that is Chifungo, which we're probably going to do in the next 2 days.
Nandolo,
Nyemba.
I just said Dosova.
Oh, Dosova.
The maize in this area didn't produce very well this year because they didn't have access to the fertilizer. They didn't qualify for the subsidy. They haven't done intercropping because they don't have access to the seeds. There's no source for the seeds for the beans that they would use for intercropping. So anyway, we're learning a lot about the kinds of problems that they're experiencing and trying to see how that would influence the topics that we would suggest for any kind of videos that we produce. So, but I think it's also just good for us to walk around and find out, you know, what they're planting, where they're planting it, and why, and if they haven't used fertilizer, why or why not, and if they haven't taken advantage of this technique to produce their own organic fertilizer using manure, how come? What they know how to do it, but we're learning about all of the obstacles to doing it for especially for fields as large. It's not going to be practical when they're so far from the source of water.
I think there's something that maybe we as researchers don't know about this technology that the farmers may want people to pay attention to.
I mean, this could be an important component to an addition to this digital green method, which is still largely one way. You know, it's you make the video,
you make
you bring
the video,
it,
just bring, but not getting
they discuss, yeah. But maybe the actual techniques aren't correct. And when they're discussing, they could be talking about all of the better ways to do it in their context, and then that could then be used as input into some new training materials.
Not nearly as many farmers appear to use or even have access to mobile phones. This presented a problem, as teaching rural farmers how to effectively use mobiles to access agricultural services was a major component of our project. We continued with the baseline surveys, observing the data and speaking directly with farmers to get a better sense of how we could adapt our participatory video method to what they could actually find useful. By the end of week two, we knew we had to adjust our approach, and we were eager to learn more. Fukata in the Dikula section was the last village we visited for the baseline surveys. Chip and Susan handed out the last of the surveys, the enumerators discussed with Charles, the extension officer, who they should interview, and then they left to complete those. The day before, though, we met with Lester Magombo, a farmer from Chisiri. He had some insight on the mobile phone usage in the area.
We have been trained how to use a phone, a cell phone.
To send a cell phone
to send a message to the Ministry headquarters. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did you learn anything about receiving? Did you receive messages?
Yeah, we do receive the messages, but in the past I have been receiving, but the card has been broken. So because of that, at the moment I'm not receiving because I haven't renewed the cell phone number.
Cell phone number.
Yeah.
What kind of messages were you receiving?
We were receiving messages from areas which pests
like when there's an outbreak of pests. Eh?
Yeah.
Mm.
So they warn farmers that there's now an outbreak or diseases.
Yeah.
Like there, in the upper main stalk, eh? You see those things. When it's attacked, it turns into black color.
Into black color.
While the stalk is green.
Oh.
Yeah, before it has dried like that.
And that's a kind of, that's caused by a pest?
That's a mean smart, head smart. So if there's an attack like that one, if it has attacked the whole, like a big area, they will send the message that farmers should do maybe like just removing the upper part.
We were aware that Isoko, the SMS-based communication platform for farmers operating in several African countries, had been in use here, and we wanted to learn about its influence in the communities we were studying.
So from the extension officer, we learned that last year she had done some training on the Isoko service, and we were a little bit surprised because most of the farmers hadn't told us that they'd even heard of Isoko. And then we learned that actually when they did the training, which was sponsored by Isoko, they didn't use the name Isoko in the discussion. They actually referred to it as the Agricultural Services by Mobile Phone Service and Chichewa. So it was all done in Chichewa. Were there ever messages talking about the price of maize?
Yeah.
Yeah?
We farmers, we should be aware of that prices. So that we should also sell that particular price. Mm. So that we should have a benefit.
Mm. Were you able to sell at the price of the market?
Of that particular area.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You sold it in a group?
Yeah, we sold it at a group.
Mm.
Yeah, we were about 50 farmers.
Did you say the club is smaller this year?
You have less number now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How come?
We are about 70.
17.
Mm. Yeah.
Some people have moved out.
Yeah.
Why?
Some are crooks. Okay. They didn't fulfill the promise.
Okay.
We
were given credit for seed.
Seed, yeah.
So some did not repay.
Mm.
So those who didn't repay,
they dropped them out. I see. It became very clear that farmers have a strong distrust of revealing exactly how much maize they had collected. They didn't really want other people to know how much maize they had because they feared that that would just make them a target for theft. So security, safety seems to be a real big challenge in getting farmers to cooperate and group together. I do think trust is a really big problem, and we're going to have to deal with that.
This was one of the smaller warehouses.
We visited the Agricultural Commodities Exchange, or ACE, warehouse for the Dedza district to see where it was Lester's failed cooperative stored their maize. Despite the results of Lester's story, there seemed to be quite a lot of maize and beans stored in the warehouse. We continued on to the ACE headquarters in Lilongwe to ask about their usage of Isoko in training farmers. They said they had stopped using Isoko and started using their own platform, which would explain why some of the farmers we'd interviewed were no longer receiving Isoko texts.
We've been doing a lot of thinking about what the content of the videos should be, we are reevaluating how important it would be to teach farmers about mobile phone agricultural services. We're really recognizing that what we'll need to do is work very closely with the extension officers to cover some of the topics that they're already working on developing training for. And that way the videos can be focusing on what the agricultural extension officers are doing in terms of a training. We can capture that because they're interacting with lead farmers right in the community when they come out to do the training. We think that could be useful.
A clearer picture was being painted, though it was quite different from our original idea.
Get information.
One final step before Chip and Susan left and Tian went to India to learn directly from Digital Green, coding. There were 190 surveys to enter into a database. From what we were analyzing, the data were certainly compelling. With Tian and Hastings back from India, we had just a few days to settle on the content for the participatory videos. We met again with the extension officers for the Lintipi EPA to talk about a nutrition training session one of them was holding in Diapui. If there were training sessions happening, we thought it would be good to see what sort of things the farmers were actually studying.
And our approach basically is to use videos where some farmers can be taught through a video, watching a video, and maybe some will not be taught using a video. Maybe we may have to depend on the normal, the usual ways in which you reach farmers, the way you teach farmers. And then all we want to try to do is just to see how much can we use videos, how possible is it to try these other approaches for reaching farmers.
After do the screening, we may also have some evaluation of how the video effectiveness of the video. And then we hope we can target the original farmers in the baseline survey because it can give us a consistent data.
If we still want maybe follow up maybe on, let's say, 20 farmers, it would be good if we can pick from, like in Lumwina, we had 60 farmers, right? Then if we say want to target 20, we should be able to pick from that sample and then follow them.
You want to discuss after the video?
Yeah.
So you just, okay, you screen it, and then after the screening, you ask if they can do whatever is in the video.
It's
so you get the, you get the feedback from the farmers after the video.
After we do the training, we'd want to assess, has their knowledge level changed? Okay? So if it's possible, maybe we can follow up on these people which we sample. Before the training, we give them maybe a small test, one-page test. They don't have to write, we may ask them. And then see how they score. You do the training. At the end, we can also follow up on the very same farmers and administer the same test to see if there is an improvement on the areas which they failed. And then after some time, I think about a week, after a week, want to come back and then assess, how many have done what you taught them? Because I think we can have more impact if we do that. They said they are going to do A, B, C, D. You have taught them, are they able to do that? And have they done it?
Traediki alangiza boma azirangiza kumudzi abambo komaso amai moni ose
zibomo yakai shoko kodi ya beta bwera kuno ndoti nizo tikadzivane nayo vatu ikubva endowa ena rwadziwe rwadziwe ana bwera aswa bwera wake lesu zoma yatipange kutifeti zwane go mwadziwa sogo kawo Mainao. Kufane. Manoti yuwa wakambili afaje sinafe. Ainzuri ya tifusili ya ndisi.
Awenda buwanji. Mwapuzili ya kujaya ni mbuyo mu. Na yungati kumbali memu ya ringate kusanga. Kumbali one kumbali. Fana kasi mwapuzili nda mbili mbili. Kuli mwapuzili waza kuja. Mwapuzili wakali midwe. Mwapuzili wanta ya kasu.
Tsikuli jali mene tima kambila na kutitiza kandi. Zo jambula jambula kanema wazo pika pika. Lafika.
The training sessions were very informative, and tasting all the food was great too. We started to get a good idea of what would be important for the farmers to know. We decided on two topics, conservation agriculture and nutrition. In one video, we would teach basic methods for mulching using leftover maize stalks and other organic waste. In the other, we would instruct both men and women the steps to creatively prepare their leftovers and some underutilized ingredients to make an easy-to-prepare, delicious, nutritious dish, nyama ya mkute and nyama ya chulue. We made sure to add humor and a storyline to the videos to make them a bit more interesting. Then we went back to the villages to implement our research design. Some villages only viewing the video treatment, some only receiving the traditional training, and one receiving both. Before viewing, the people interviewed in the baseline survey had to complete a pre-test, and after they left, they had to complete a post-test. A week later, we surveyed again for adoption verification.
We then began to clean the data and see what sort of conclusions we could make from it. There was quite a bit to work through. After 2 months, Tian and I left Malawi, Hastings moved back to LUANAR, and the research continued from different parts of the globe.
This was a really successful implementation project this summer. You know, the bigger part of our summer project was to test the idea of participatory videos, and those really worked surprisingly well.
We find that the video training method is as effective as the traditional extension workers training. In terms of helping farmers receive information and improve their knowledge.
Video-based training, if done correctly, that is where you're using local actors and you're involving the local community and you're connected with the extension apparatus that knows what the needs of the local communities are. You know, if you really make use of those types of assets in the creation of videos, learning follows.
We do expect to go back to the same extension planning area, EPA, to expand our video project.
People there, you know, through LUANAR and through the Ministry of Agriculture, could continue to not only produce videos when they want, to complement their field school work and their live demonstrations, but also put into place a way for those farmers to review those videos anytime they want.
We had very good local collaborator, students and faculties, and also we appreciate the participants of local farmers. They contribute their times and help us understand better how participatory media works in Malawi.
Malawi was a beautiful country. It was fantastic actually visiting there. The people were warm and very friendly and very cooperative. And they're eager to learn about these new approaches. You know, it was just a great experience.